Amen.
I hope everyone has their notes. Top of page one, the passage that's capital letters is capital letters because that's the way it appears in the appendix in early writings. And this is a comment, an appendix comment on early writings, page 42, 43. And who doesn't have notes? Raise your hands. Two up here. Okay. Recently, Brother Mark, Tree of Life Ministries, has come out with another post in the chat room, which conclusively demonstrates that the movement, the organization that they're in, is a totally different organization than what we're in. They've reached the point now to where they've understand they have the spiritual authority to start taking portions of Sister White's writings and selecting them out of context and making their applications upon them. And this is kind of for me personally, a weight. For me, I could see where they were going for quite some time. Then recently, he made an application where he busted apart a passage of the Spirit of Prophecy and put a wrong application upon it. And then he's followed up with this one with the same argument. There's no way what they're now teaching has anything to do with what was being taught from 1989 onward. I hope to show that to you this morning. The quote that he put in the chat room, which it appears that his disciples quickly jumped on and said, amen, amen, is found in early writings, page 42, 43. So I went to the appendix here because it's referenced in early writings, page 42 and 43. And it says, concerning her personal relationship to this matter and the matter that we're going to discuss is the shut door controversy. If you're not aware of it, shortly after October 22nd, 1844, there became a controversy over the shut door. It was an accusation as much as anything else against Sister White's prophetic authority. But what I'm suggesting is that just before midnight, this shut door controversy gets repeated, and that's what we're involved in now. How these guys are applying the shut door is totally different. It's totally error. But it's totally different than what we have been applying it since 1989. And they're a different movement at minimum, but if you're looking at the Council on the Alpha and Omega, then they are the new organization, the new movement. And they're calling us the Omega, okay, which contributes to this, all right? So in this appendix, it'll be self-explanatory as we go through. This appendix is talking about the shut door controversy in her day and age, which she's referenced in early writings, page 42 and onward. She says, concerning her own personal relationship to this matter, she wrote in 1874 that she never had a vision that no more sinners would be converted, nor did she ever teach this view. She never had a vision of it, she never taught it, but she did believe it until the Lord gave her light on it. Okay, that was the understanding during that time period, and until she had her first vision, just like every other Millerite, she believed it. And it was quite some time before Sister White quit eating pork. Okay, so this is the reality of her growth in holiness, her growth in understanding. As light came to her, she accepted it. So this isn't an accusation that can be used to disqualify her prophetic authority. She understood the closed door as the Millerites did until she received a vision. That clarified it for her and for them. And she notes that she never taught it, never published it, okay? So she never had a vision that no more sinners would be converted, nor did she ever teach this view. It was the light given me of God, she wrote at another time, that corrected our error and enabled us to see the true position. So this is the appendix. I don't want you to get confused here. On early writings, page 42 and 43. Onward. And for more information about this subject, the appendix says you can look at Selected Messages, Book 1, page 74 and 63. So before we get into the heart of what we're looking at, I have for you those passages in Selected Messages, Book 1, page 74 and 63. And what I want you to see in here is she's going to be identifying three different people, two men and a woman, and others, she says, that were distorting her understanding publicly. Anyway, this is from early writings, from Selected Messages, Book 1, page 74. I hereby testify in the fear of God that the charges of Miles Grant, of Mrs. Burdick, and others published in The Crisis are not true. The statements in reference to my course in 44 are false. My course in 1844 are false. With my brethren and sisters, after the time passed in 44, I did believe no more sinners would be converted, but I never had a vision that no more sinners would be converted. And am clear and free to state no one has ever heard me say or has read from my pen statements which will justify them in the charges they have made against me upon this point. I'm not arguing that any of this, what we just read, has anything to do with an application here at the end of the world. This is just an overview of the shut door controversy in this history, okay? But that history is at the beginning of Adventism is illustrating a history at the end of Adventism. So there are some characteristics from this shut door that apply now. Next paragraph. It was on my first journey east to relate my visions that the precious light in regard to the heavenly sanctuary was opened before me, and I was shown the open and shut door. We believed that the Lord was soon to come in the clouds of heaven. I was shown that there was a great work to be done in the world for those who had not received light and rejected it. I was shown that there was a great work to be done in the world for those who had not had the light and rejected it. Okay, the reason she's saying that is the Millerite understanding at that time before this vision is that anyone that wasn't in the Millerite movement was lost. The door of probation was closed for all mankind because Jesus was about to return. When she gets a vision, she's shown an open door and a shut door. And what she is emphasizing here is those that had not the light and rejected it were still open for the possibility of conversion. The Lord's opening their understanding about this history. Our brethren could not understand this. The brethren weren't sympathetic with her position. Our brethren could not understand this with our faith in the immediate appearing of Christ. Some accused me of saying that the Lord delayeth his coming, especially the fanatical ones. I saw that in 44, God had opened a door and no man could shut it, and shut a door and no man could open it. Those who rejected the light which was brought to the world by the message of the second angel went into darkness. And how great was that darkness? So she's identifying that the people that do close their door of probation are the ones that reject the light of the second angel, which I want you to take note of because the second angel's message returns again at 9/11. All right, so this is a component of that history. Amen. Now, this is the next passage is the passage from page 60 to 64 of Selected Messages, Book 1, that the appendix referred us to about the shut door controversy. And this has some more information in it. There is another fact that should be stated here. I'm not responsible for all that has been printed as coming from me. She's telling us that there was publications going that were making claims about what she was saying, and she's letting us know, just because someone says I said it, or just because it is some words that I have used that are misrepresented, it doesn't mean that I'm standing by it. And that's what's going on with Brother Mark and the Tree of Life ministry now, and the other ministries are all saying amen. Okay, and I'll show that to you. It's pretty simple to see now. They've reached the point where it's simple to see, if you're willing to see. About the time that my earliest visions were first published, several articles did appear purporting to have been written by me and to relate what the Lord has shown me, but sanctioning doctrines which I did not believe. These were published in a paper edited by a Mr. Curtis. Or you might say these were put on the internet in the chat rooms. Okay. Of the name of the paper, I'm not certain. In the years of care and labor that have passed since then, some of the less important particulars have been forgotten, but the main points are still distinct in my mind. This man took articles that came from my pen and wholly transformed and distorted them, picking out a sentence here and there without giving any connection, and then, after inserting his own ideas, he attached my name to them as if they came direct from me. What I want you to see is this is part of what was going on in the shut door controversy immediately after October 22nd, 1844. The spirit of prophecy was being distorted, and it was being put into a context where it would uphold a private interpretation. And this gets repeated just before the door closes at the end, because this is a prophetic chiasm. And everyone so far, everyone involved in this movement and even in the other movement, will agree that midnight is typified by October 22nd, 1844. So you've got 1844, 1844, Jesus illustrates the end from the beginning. Okay. Now you may argue, well, this shut door controversy has to take place over here, but not so. This chiasm, it has to take place beforehand. That's what we're arguing over right now, is does the door shut at midnight or does it shut a few steps beyond midnight? We're having that controversy now before midnight. On seeing these articles, we wrote him, expressing our surprise and disapprobation and forbidding him thus to misconstrue my testimonies. He answered and said he should publish what he pleased, that he knew the visions ought to say what he had published, and that if I had written them as the Lord gave them to me, they would have said these things. He asserted that if the visions have been given for the benefit of the church, he had right to use them as he pleased. Okay, this is echoing the attitude of Tree of Life Ministry, but it was frustrating for a while. Now it's sad. It's sad that these disciples of his aren't paying close enough attention to the application that he's making to actually just go ahead and read the whole paragraph or read the context of the paragraph to recognize that the whole intent of Sister White's words are being turned upside down. It's becoming not so frustrating anymore. Now it's becoming sad. Some of these sheets may still be in existence and may be brought forward as coming from me, but I am not responsible for them. The articles given in early writings did pass under my eye, and as the edition of Experience and Views published in 1851 was the earliest which we possessed, and as we had no knowledge of anything additional in papers or pamphlets of earlier date, I am not responsible for the omissions which are said to exist. Now, this Curtis was saying that there was portions from Experience and Views that had things removed, and the things that were removed, this Curtis was saying, would prove that she held to the Millerite understanding of the shut door, therefore she was a false prophet. Okay, so she's going to go through here and give the whole context of what was removed and why it was not a denial of what she's saying about her understanding of the shut door. It was just a purposeful misrepresentation of her work, okay? So you can read that on page 2 down where it says the first omission. That is the subtitle from Selected Messages, book 1 that we're reading. And then the next subtitle is the shut door doctrine. So I'm going to pass over her explanation about how this passage was deleted and why it was deleted. You can read it for yourself. But where it says the shut door defined, it says, it is claimed that these expressions prove the shut door doctrine and that this is the reason of their omission in later editions. But in fact, they teach only that which has been and is still held by us of a people, as I shall show. For a time after the disappointment in 1844, I did hold, in common with the Advent body, that the door of mercy was then forever closed to the world. This position was taken before my first vision was given me. It was the light given me of God that corrected our error and enabled us to see our true position. I am still a believer in the shut door theory, but not in the sense in which we first employed the term or in which it is employed by my opponents. There was a shut door in Noah's day. Next paragraph. There was a shut door in the days of Abraham. Next paragraph. There was a shut door in the day in Christ's day. Next paragraph, looking down the stream of time to the last days, the same infinite power proclaimed through John, these things saith he that is holy and he that is true, he that hath the key of David, and he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I was shown in vision, And I still believe that there was a shut door in 1844. All who saw the light of the first and second angels' messages and rejected that light were left in darkness. Let me remind you that the light of 9/11 is the light of the first and second angels' messages. Okay, so this is being repeated here. All who saw the light of the first and second angels' messages and had rejected that light were left in darkness. And, see, there's two classes here. And those who accepted that light, who accepted it, and received the Holy Spirit, which attended the proclamation of the message from heaven, and who afterwards renounced their faith and pronounced their experience a delusion, thereby rejected the Spirit of God, and it no longer pleaded with them. Okay, if this is the light of the first and second angels' message in the Millerite history, and we bring it to 9/11, then there's two basic classes that she's typifying here. One is the Adventist church by and large. They just rejected the light of 9/11, which was the light of the first and second angels' message. But then there's those among Adventists that have accepted that light, agreed that it was the light of the Holy Spirit, but they turn against it. And you'll notice that those that accept the light and thereafter turn against it, they do one other thing. They pronounce that light a delusion. Okay, and these guys, following the Tree of Life ministry, are now saying that the message, the movement that we're in, is the Omega, which is a delusion. So they're doing the very thing that was done by those that rejected the light of the first and second angels' message in Millerite history. Those who did not see the light had not the guilt of its rejection. So she's dealing with the Millerite idea that probation had closed for everyone, and she's saying what the Lord showed her is that there was a group of people that had not heard the light and rejected it in any way, shape, or form, and the door of probation was still open for them. Those who did not see the light had not the guilt of its rejection. It was only the class who had despised the light from heaven that the Spirit of God could not reach. And this class included, as I've stated before, notice she's emphasizing this as well as me, and this class included, as I stated before, both those who refused to accept the message when it was presented to them, and also those who, having received it, afterwards renounced their faith. These might have a form of godliness and profess to be followers of Christ, but having no living connection with God, they would be taken captive by the delusions of Satan. These two classes are brought to view in the vision. Those who declared the light which they had followed a delusion and the wicked world, see, the ones that had the light but rejected it, they're the ones that are declaring the light to be a delusion, and the wicked world just rejected it outright. These two classes are brought to view in the vision. Those who declared the light which they had followed a delusion, and the wicked of the world who, having rejected the light, had been rejected of God. No reference is made to those who had not seen the light and therefore were not guilty of its rejection. In order to prove that I believed and taught the shut door doctrine, Mr. C. gives a quotation from the review of June 11, 1861, signified by 9 of our prominent members. So they go into, pardon me? Signed by 9 of our prophet. So this Curtis that's attacking Sister White, he's going to go into a position paper written by 9 Millerites who were saying that probation had closed for everyone, and say just because you have 9 Millerites that have taken this position, that proves that Ellen White took that position. Okay, so what they're saying is that Curtis's work is going to include taking things in our history that people have said and put it in the light as if this is a position that has been formally taken. There's some of that going on as well. Okay, so it says here, Mr. C, where was I? In order to prove that I believed and taught the shut door doctrine, Mr. C gives a quotation from the review of June 11, 1861, signed by 9 of our prominent members. The quotation reads as follows. Our views of the work before us were then mostly vague and indefinite, some still retaining the idea adopted by the body of Advent believers in 1844 with William Miller at the head, that our work for the world was finished and that the message was confined to those of the original Advent faith. So firmly was this belief that one of our number was nearly refused the message, the individual presenting it having doubts of the possibility of his salvation because he was not in the 44 movement. To this I need only to add that in the same meeting in which it was urged that the message could not be given to this brother, a testimony was given me through vision to encourage him to hope in God and give his heart fully to Jesus, which he did then and there. Okay, so she's showing that the accusations made against her are false in this shut door message. And then Malachi 3:6, Hebrews 13:8 are two verses that identify that the Lord does not change and Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So whatever the characteristics of the shut door doctrine were back then are going to have to be reflected at the end, because she's already given us several witnesses: Noah, Abraham, Christ, the Millerites. God doesn't change, okay? So here is the most recent posting on page 4. And this is where he's going to quote from early writings. And his point he's going to make by, Brother M is going to make by using capital letters, okay? So this is from early writings, page 42. Sabbath, March 24th, 1849, we had sweet and very interesting meeting with the brethren at Topsham, Maine. The Holy Ghost was poured out upon us, and I was taken off in the Spirit to the city of the living God. Then I was shown the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus relating to this shut door could not be separated, and that the time for the commandments of God to shine out with all their importance, and that the time for the commandments of God to shine out with all their importance and for God's people to be tried on the Sabbath truth was when the door was opened. You notice what he's emphasizing there. That when the door is opened at midnight, this is when the light of the Sabbath truth is going to shine out and test us. Because that's what happened in 1844. Okay? And that's pretty much his whole point. But he leaves the rest of the paragraph, which says, in the most holy place, in the heavenly sanctuary, where the ark is, in which are contained the Ten Commandments. The door was not opened until the mediation of Jesus was finished in the holy place of the sanctuary in 1844. Then Jesus rose up and shut the door of the holy place and opened the door into the most holy and passed within the second veil, where he now stands by the ark and where the faith of Israel now reaches. I'm going to deal with this in a second. Okay, so just we'll come back to this. In his internet chat room, he puts in this next quote from Evangelism 2:21, which is a good quote. Not going to take time to read it. Read it. It says that everyone in this room should become intelligent in their understanding of what's going on in the most holy place and Christ's work in the investigative judgment. Okay, there's nothing erroneous about this quote at all. There's nothing erroneous about the early writings quote, except that he's putting an incorrect slant on it. The quote's fine, but he's leading his followers to see it incorrectly. But I'm not going to deal with this second quote. All I can say to the second quote is amen. We should become intelligent. If he was, he wouldn't be going this direction. He's not. How sad that you have to kind of use a type of hypnosis, okay? That when you are attacking what's going on in the most holy place investigative judgment time period, once you misrepresent an inspired statement to uphold your private interpretation, then you throw in a quote that makes it sound as if you were really understanding the investigative judgment like you're supposed to. It is a type of hypnosis if you want to check out that technique, okay? So in this chat room, as soon as he gets done with this, another person responds, just bam, amen, the door of probation is still open when the Sabbath test comes. So if you don't think that was his intent, it's clearly expressed by one of his disciples. I would guess that this is one of his disciples that was here for so long. Okay, because out in these chat rooms, there's about 10 of them. They look like an army, but it's generally just those 10. Okay, but they're active. And then he responds, amen, brother. It doesn't It doesn't close until after your third test. Until after your third test. This is Brother M. And then he repeats the quote that we've already dealt with previously about the Lord has shown me clearly that the image of the beast will be formed before probation closes. It's got three paragraphs. He leaves off the first two, which defines the third one, and he takes the third one and uses it completely out of context to make it sound the way he wants to, that probation is still open when the Sunday law comes. It's interesting that this shut door, there was a shut door controversy at the beginning of Adventism, but after 1989, there was a shut door controversy at the beginning of this movement. Does probation really close for Seventh-day Adventists at the Sunday law? And the answer was resoundingly, yes, it closes at the Sunday law. Okay, so this is like the third shut door controversy, one at the beginning of Adventism, one at the beginning of this reform movement, now the one here at the end. And this one's taken the same approach as all the others, is that probation is open even after the door is closed, which is a scary place to be. Now, where it says resting the inspired word, this is taken from one of his previous chat rooms. We've already dealt with this. He quotes from 15 manuscript releases, page 15. And then he says, it says this, this is the test the people of God must have before they are sealed. All who prove their loyalty to God, there's his emphasis, it's in capital letters, by observing his law and refusing to accept the spurious Sabbath will rank under the banner of the Lord God Jehovah and will receive the seal of the living God. Those who yield the truth of heavenly origin and accept the Sunday Sabbath will receive the mark of the beast. You have to pass the test of observance to his law before you can receive the seal of God during the testing crisis. Now, this is the third paragraph of three paragraphs. And by taking the third, he makes it sound like this is the Sunday law test that you have to pass. But if you read these two paragraphs that lead into it, as we're going to do, you will find that the test that you have to pass is the image of the beast test that comes before the Sunday law test. It says, the Lord has shown me clearly that the image of the beast will be formed before probation closes. For it is to be the great test for the people of God by which their eternal destiny will be decided. Your position is such a jumble of inconsistencies that but few will be deceived. In Revelation 13, this subject is plainly presented. And if you go and read Revelation 13, 11 through 17, you'll see it's the outlining of the setting up of the image of the beast. All right? It's the image of the beast test that's being discussed here on both those paragraphs. And then the third paragraph says this. This is the test that the people of God must have before they are sealed. They must have the image of the beast test before they're sealed, and inspiration is clear that we receive the seal at the Sunday law. Okay, so he's rested this one paragraph out to make it sound like you're going to get the seal during the Sunday law crisis, during the process of the Sunday law crisis. And now he's went a step further with this quote from early writings where he's taking this history and misrepresenting it. But let's just keep on the notes. These guys evidently don't know the lines of truth that have been laid down even well before 9/11. Okay, one of them is this next quote. The image of the beast represents that form of apostate Protestantism which will be developed when the Protestant churches shall seek the aid of the civil power for the enforcement of their dogmas. The mark of the beast still remains to be defined. The image of the beast and the mark of the beast are two different things. Okay, he left off those first two paragraphs, but in order to avoid the subject of the image of the beast and make it sound like it's all the mark of the beast, okay? But the mark of the beast, the image of the beast, are two different things, and they're not wanting to any longer make that distinction, okay? So now what I've got here is the passage from early writings 42 that he quoted on the chat room that I took the appendix comment from to start this whole presentation. And the paragraph that he quoted is the one I have in the box. But I have a few more paragraphs after it. And I want you to see some things now about the paragraph that he quoted. Sabbath, March 24th, 1849, we had sweet and very interesting meeting with the brethren at Topsham, Maine. The Holy Ghost was poured out upon us, and I was taken off in the Spirit to the city of the living God. Then I was shown the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ relating to the shut door could not be separated, and that the time for the commandments of God to shine out with all their importance, and for God's people to be tried on the Sabbath truth when the door was open in the most holy place. The reason I have that bold-faced is that's what he had in capital letters. This was his emphasis. That's all he wanted his readers to see. For God's people to be tried on the Sabbath truth was when the door was opened in the most holy place, in the heavenly sanctuary, where the ark is, in which are contained the Ten Commandments. The door was not opened until the mediation of Jesus was finished in the holy place of the sanctuary in 1844. Then Jesus rose up. Now, the reason I have that underlined in boldface is kind of outside the scope of this particular study, but Thursday in class, we inserted the classic passage when the great buildings of New York City are thrown down by the touch of the Lord. Everyone know that quote? She says, "Then the Lord will stand up and arise and shake terribly the earth." And in that class, we pointed out that when the Lord stands up, it marks a change of dispensation. So if you have a pen, just for your own edification, if you want to check it out, Daniel 12:1, Michael stands up. It's a change of dispensation because human probation closes. Acts 7:55 through 57, Michael stands up again, and the Lord has just divorced ancient Israel as his people. And he's entered into covenant with the Christian church. Change of dispensation. In Isaiah 14:22, and also in Isaiah 28:21, and also in Isaiah 33:10, you will see the Lord standing up, parallel passages to Daniel 12:1, because in those three places, the Lord is going to do his strange work, which is the seven last plagues, his executive judgment. When he's going to change dispensation, when he puts off the priestly garments and puts on the garments of vengeance, you have Daniel 12:1, you have Isaiah 14:22, Isaiah 28:21, Isaiah 33:10, and also in Zephaniah 3:8, the Lord stands up to mark the executive judgment. So you have plenty of witnesses, but here, Sister White says, then Jesus rose up. On October 22nd, 1844, Jesus rose up and moved from the holy place to the most holy place. So you have that when human probation closes, the Lord rises up on several witnesses. A change of dispensation. October 22nd, 1844, Jesus rises up. A change of dispensation from the holy to the most holy. When Stephen is stoned, Jesus stands up, a change of dispensation from the Jewish church to the Christian church. Therefore, when Sister White says, when the great buildings of New York City were thrown down by a touch of God, which we understand to be 9/11, and the Lord arose to shake terribly the earth at that time, there had to be a change of dispensation at 9/11. It had to be something. So what would the obvious change of dispensation be at 9/11? The judgment of the living was underway. Although these guys want to say, no. The judgment of the living doesn't begin until midnight. So does the great buildings of New York City come down again at midnight? But how do you get away from that? Okay. What kind of blindness is it to walk away from that, that there had to be some kind of change of dispensation? And where is Jesus right now? He's in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. What change of dispensation would be taking place in the most holy place of a heavenly sanctuary at 9/11 when the great buildings of New York City came down with the touch of God? Okay, it's got to be the judgment of the living begins, okay? But they're not seeing it. Then Jesus rose up back to the passage and shut the door of the holy place and opened the door of the most holy and passed within the second veil. He now stands by the ark where the faith of Israel now reaches. Continuing on. I saw that Jesus had shut the door of the holy place and no man could open it, and he had opened the door in the most holy place and no man can shut it. And that since Jesus had opened the door in the most holy place, which contains the ark, the commandments have been shining out to God's people, and they are being tested on the Sabbath question. Who's being tested on the Sabbath questions? God's people. Since when? Since October 22nd, 1844, the Sabbath test is testing God's people. He's arguing the testing of the Sabbath for God's people takes place from midnight onward. Okay, if you haven't settled into this truth before midnight, you're lost as a Seventh-day Adventist. And he's putting the testing off over here. Peace. You got more time. This is a peace and safety message, even though they don't realize it. By the context, the very quote that he's using is identifying that the testing of the Sabbath began on October 22nd, 1844, and he's putting it off to midnight. There's a person getting baptized here today. He's got it. He has to already settled into the Sabbath understanding before his baptism, or you're not going to baptize him, right? You got to assent to the doctrines that we hold before the church agrees to baptize you. So anyone that's a Seventh-day Adventist is tested on the Sabbath when they first join Adventism, and then their growth in holiness, they're going to be tested on the Sabbath all the way through. Are you guarding the borders of the Sabbath? Are you keeping the Sabbath holy from beginning to end? Okay, this is the testing time on the Sabbath, beginning on October 22nd, 1844, and it's a test. Yes, 44 is the arrival of the third angel's message, but that's what the third angel is opening up to them, is the Ten Commandments. So yeah, it's a period of time where they're coming. I stand corrected in terms of 1846, but it's a period of time that we may get to over here. Okay, so I saw that the present, next paragraph, that the present test on the Sabbath could not come until the mediation of Jesus in the holy place was finished and he'd passed within the second veil. Therefore, Christians who fell asleep before the door was opened into the most holy, when the midnight cry was finished at the seventh month, 1844, and who had not kept the true Sabbath, now rest in hope, for they had not the light in the test on the Sabbath, which we now have since the door was opened. He's putting the test on Sabbath, future tense, brothers and sisters. Future tense. She was putting it here and now, 150 years ago. Amen. For they had no light on the... I saw that Satan was tempting some of God's people on this point because so many good Christians have fallen asleep in the triumphs of faith and have not kept the true Sabbath. They were doubting about its being a test for us now. This next short paragraph, very provocative. If you have the time to look at it, I'm going to read it. If we get time to look at it, I'll come back to it. But it's dealing with the argument against what happened at 9/11. But you have to take some time with it. It says, the enemies of present truth have been trying to open the door of the holy place that Jesus has shut and to close the door of the most holy place, which he opened in 1844. And if you want to see how this applies at the end, don't struggle so much about the opening of the holy place and the closing of the holy place and the opening of the most holy place. Put it in the terms of a change of dispensation. If you'd put it in the terms of the change of dispensation, when the holy place was closed and the most holy was opened, that change of dispensation is 9/11. Okay, so it says the enemies of present truth are trying to destroy what happened at 9/11. Okay, and you can carry it on through, but maybe we'll get back to that. I doubt it. Which opened in 1844, where the ark is, containing the two tables of stone on which are written the Ten Commandments, the Ten Commandments by the finger of Jehovah. Satan is now using every device in this sealing time. So when did the sealing time start? In the context of here, it's October 22nd, 1844. The sealing started, all right? Now, what I'm saying is, in order to uphold their false teaching, you have to take the teaching of this movement from the very beginning and throw it in the trash can. It's not simply what's come after 9/11, okay? It's when I went to put the following quotes together, I went back to a sermon that was put in the public record shortly after we moved to Arkansas, and we've been here how many years?
Since
99. Since 99. Okay, so this is 15, 16 years old.
18.
Yeah. I've been married that long. Okay, 18. Long time ago. And what we understood about 9/11 didn't come at 9/11. What we understand about 9/11 come about 2004. All right? So this is long before the light of 9/11. And I'm just going to read through these so you can see a principle here. Desire of Ages, page 63. From this point, their pride and stubbornness grew into a settled hatred of the Savior. While God was opening the door to the Gentiles, the Jewish leaders were closing the door to themselves. Okay, so when there's a door being opened, there's a door being closed. Now, these next three quotes, and the third quote has two paragraphs, these next three quotes are all dealing with the Sunday law because they're dealing with the 11th hour workers, and that's the other illustration I thought about putting up here, but I don't think I will. I think you can hold this concept in your head, is that when we take the characteristics of the Sunday law, the prophetic characteristics of the Sunday law, that apply to the 11th hour workers, we take those same characteristics back to the midnight cry and apply it to the Levites, and we take those same characteristics back to midnight and apply it to the priests. Everyone can hold that concept in your head, yes? Okay, so these next three quotes, I only have to read one, you test it out, they're saying the same thing, and it's this, and when I read this first quote, then I will tell you the point I'm trying to make. Many who have known the truth have corrupted their way before God and have departed from the faith. The broken ranks will be filled up by those represented by Christ as coming in at the 11th hour. That's the Sunday law. There are many with whom the Spirit of God is striving. The time of God's destructive judgments, national apostasies followed by national ruin, is a time of mercy for those who have no opportunity to learn what is truth. Tenderly will the Lord look upon these 11th hour workers that haven't had an opportunity to learn what the truth of the Sabbath is before the Sunday law crisis hits. Tenderly will the Lord look upon them. His heart of mercy is touched. His hand is stretched out still to save while the door is closed to those who would not enter. So at the Sunday law, the door is closed on Seventh-day Adventists that would not enter into the Sabbath truth. Okay, but it's open to the 11th hour workers. And if you back that up to the midnight cry, the door is closed on the Levites, okay, the priest, the door is closed over the priests at midnight. Did I say midnight? The midnight cry, okay. Back it up to the midnight cry. The door is closed upon the Levites. And everyone associated with that light is held accountable one way or another, but it's opening to those that are going to come in the following history. So too with midnight. The door is closed for the priest at midnight, but there's still a class of people that are open to the light that have not rejected it. You follow that? Maybe I should have had that on the board. But that's pretty simple, yes? Do I see any vague looks out there? Okay. So, that's the point, is the closing of the door here, it's the same, on October 22nd, 1844, that's what Sister White was saying. Down here, this is what's illustrated down here. October 22nd, 1844, there's two classes that reject the message of the second angel. You with me? The two classes were those that just outright rejected it, and then those that received it and afterwards pronounced it a delusion, which in our history, they're saying it's an omega. But this is that they're saying we're the omega. This is the characteristic of every closing of the door. Okay, there's a door closed on a group of people that are held accountable for the light that came before that closed door, and at the same time, the door is opening to those people that have not received that light and aren't held accountable to that light. You with me? Okay, now, the bottom of page 6. this is the point of the whole point, I think, this particular quote here. The work of the Holy Spirit is to convince the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. The world can only be warned. Who's the world? The 11th hour workers, okay? I mean, the whole world is, but it's the 11th hour workers that are going to accept the warning and respond correctly, right? The world can only be warned by seeing those who believe the truth, sanctified through the truth, acting upon high and holy principles, showing in a high, elevated sense the line of demarcation between those who keep the commandments of God and those who trample them under their feet. So when are the commandments of God trampled under their feet? At the Sunday law. At the Sunday law, the world can only be warned when they see the crisis of the Sunday law and that there are two classes of people at that time period, that their visual test, they're seeing two classes of people. They're seeing one class of people that are upholding God's law in the crisis and the other class that are trampling them under their feet. But they're a third class. They're watching this. They're trying to receive this visual manifestation as a warning message to them. And it's saying the only way the world can be warned is in this Sunday law crisis, and I'll read on now. The sanctification of the Spirit signalizes the difference between those who have the seal of God and those who keep the spurious rest day. Now notice, the sanctification of the Spirit, go up to the second sentence. I'm going to reread it. The world can only be warned by seeing those who believe the truth sanctified through the truth. In this next two sentences down, she's going to define what that means. She says, the sanctification of the Spirit signalizes the difference between those who have the seal of God and those who keep the spurious rest day. What is she saying is the world, the 11th hour workers, can only be warned if they see men and women in the Sunday law crisis with the seal of God.
Amen.
Okay? So at each one of these waymarks, you have to have men and women that receive the seal of God right there when the door closes, because that's the only warning the next class can get. And to teach that when that door closes, you have a period of time whether you're choosing to accept the seal of God or not, is to deny, at minimum, it's to deny the very teaching that this movement's been teaching for 20-some years, and it shows that this other movement out there is a totally different movement on lots of levels. When the test comes, it will be clearly shown what the mark of the beast is. It is the keeping of Sunday. Those who, after having heard the truth, continue to regard this day as holy, bear the signature of the man of sin who thought to change times and laws. Now, very quickly, I'm how much time I have over there? Okay, this here, these next quotes, this series of quotes, is pretty much taken from this same study roughly over 15 years ago. The judgment of the living is progressive, and the argument for that is this. First quote, as the books of record are opened in the judgment, the lives of all who have believed on Jesus come in review before God, beginning with those who first lived upon the earth, beginning with Adam. Our advocate presents the cases of each successive generation and closes with the living. It's progressive. It begins with the dead, it moves to the living. Next quote to show that it's progressive. In 1844, our great high priest entered the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary to begin the work of the investigative judgment. The cases of the righteous dead have been passing in review before God. When that work shall be completed, judgment is to be pronounced upon the living. Okay, so it begins with the dead, it moves to the living. It began in 1844, and when she wrote it, it was still dealing with the dead, but at some point she says it's going to pass to the living. Judgment is progressive. The investigative judgment is progressive. 1 Peter 4:17 also teaches that it's progressive. Let's look at 1 Peter 4:17. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall be the end of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and sinner appear? So judgment begins, the dead moves to the living. It begins with God's church. Then it goes outside of God's church. 11th hour workers get judged after we get judged. Okay, and Sister White comments on this quite a bit. Review and Herald, January 11th, 1887. The destroying angels have the commission from the Lord, begin at my sanctuary, and they begin at the ancient men which were before the house. If the warnings which God has given are neglected or regarded with indifference, if you suffer sin to be cherished, you are sealing your soul's destiny. You will be weighed in the balances and found wanting. Grace, peace, and pardon will be withdrawn forever. Jesus will have passed by, never again to come within the reach of your prayers and entreaties. It begins not only with the Church of God, but in this passage and other passage, it begins with the ancient men that stood as the guardians before the temple. She's referring to Ezekiel chapter 9 here. And if you're wondering who the ancient men are, there's a nice quote underneath there. It says the prophet, they begin at the ancient men which were before the house, Ezekiel 9, 1 through 6. The work of destruction begins among those who have professed to be the spiritual guardians of the people. The false watchmen are the first to fall. Pastors, ministries that are teaching error are the first to fall. Okay, it's progressive.
False watchmen.
Now, add into this that the investigative judgment is identified as twofold in the sense that there is a work of bookkeeping, heavenly bookkeeping that Christ does, and there's a work that you and I must do in cleansing our body temple. And it's based upon our work, what gets recorded in the books of heaven. And when Christ opens those books in heaven, our probation is over. He's opening the books to see what we've done in our probationary time. Okay? Therefore, our probationary time has to end before his books are opened. Okay? We have to have settled either we're keeping our temple corrupt or we've got it cleansed, and then he's going to open up the books. It's two parts. Notice this from General Conference Bulletin. Brethren, to whom the truths of God's word have been opened, what part will you act in the closing scenes of this world's history? Are you awake to these solemn realities? Do you realize the grand work of preparation that's going on in heaven and on earth? Let all who have received the light, who have had the opportunity of reading and hearing the prophecy, take heed to those things that are written therein, for the time is at hand. Let none now tamper with sin, the source of every misery in our world. No longer remain in lethargy and stupid indifference. Let not the destiny of your soul hang upon an uncertainty. Know that you're fully on the Lord's side. Let the inquiry go forth from sincere hearts and trembling lips. Who shall be able to stand? Have you in these last precious hours of probation been putting the very best material into your character building? Have you been purifying your souls from every stain? See, this is our work. Have you followed the light? Have your works corresponded to the profession of your faith? Is the softening, subduing influence of the grace of God working upon you? Have you hearts that can feel, eyes that can see, ears that can hear? Next quote, twofold work. Those who are living upon the earth when the intercession of Christ shall cease in the sanctuary above are to stand in the sight of a holy God without a mediator. Their robes must be spotless, their characters must be purified from sin by the blood of sprinkling. Through the grace of God and their own diligent effort, they must be conquerors in the battle of evil. While the investigative judgment is going forward in heaven, it started on October 22, 1844, while the sins of penitent believers are being removed from the sanctuary, there is to be a special work of purification, of putting away of sin among God's people on earth. This work is more clearly presented in the messages of Revelation 14. When this work shall have been accomplished, what works out? The investigative judgment in conjunction with the work that God's people do on earth in putting away sin. And the preparation work of putting away sin among God's people is going to conclude before their names come up in the books, the bookkeeping, the divine bookkeeping. Next quote. Now Christ is in the heavenly sanctuary. And what is he doing? Making atonement for us, cleansing the sanctuary from the sins of the people. Then we must enter by faith into the sanctuary with him. We must commence the work in the sanctuary of our souls. We are to cleanse ourselves from all defilement. We must cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Satan will come and tempt you, and you will give way to his temptations, and you will give way to his temptations. What then? Why, come and humble your hearts in confession, and by faith grasp the arm of Christ in the heavenly sanctuary. Believe that Christ will take your confession and hold up his hands before the Father, hands that have been bruised and wounded in our behalf, and he will make atonement for all who will come with confession. Amen. What if you cannot understand about this matter? He says, is there some of us that can't understand this? And here's why you won't be able to understand it. It's kind of a weird sentence question to me that she says, what if you cannot understand about this matter? Okay, but the way I'm understanding it is that there's going to be some of us that are incapable of understanding it, and she's going to give us the reason why in the next sentence. He says, he that lacketh these things is blind. Well, that would be a Laodicean that gets spewed out of the mouth of the Lord. He that lacketh this understanding about the requirement to purify yourself in connection with purifying your temple while Christ purifying the temple in heaven. He that can't understand these things is blind and cannot see afar off, for he has forgotten that he was purged from his own sins. What did I say? Old sins. Okay. He's forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. He's forgotten that when you first come to Christ, you're supposed to come to the foot of the cross and confess your sins, and right there and then you are justified, which means made righteous. You forgot that that was the high calling in Christ Jesus from the very beginning, since 9/11, before 9/11, since 9/11 or before 9/11, any way you look at it, the only calling for a Christian is to put away your sins. And to be saying that your sins get put away, that you go into midnight, into the most holy places with sins on you, the reason you come up with this crazy idea is because you've forgotten that your sins were already purged. And you're denying that very truth. And the only way our sins can be purged is by the blood of Christ. If you're denying that, then you are denying the sacrifice of Christ. And these guys that are buying into this are now drinking it in, hook, line, and sinker, without even testing the very passages of the spirit of prophecy that are being employed to prop up this dark, dark teaching. Amen. Okay, so now the reason that I have this next quote, is, like it or not, whether these people understand it or not, what the Tree of Life Ministry and the, what's the other name? The waters, what? The Living Water Ministries. What they're teaching now, it's a totally different message. It's a totally different message. They just haven't thrown the foundations out. They've thrown it all out. And so I went back in purposely and cut and pasted another study. We're not going to go through this. From way back when, so you can see that this understanding that when the Sunday law test comes, the door closes on those that are held accountable to that light, and the door is opened to those that aren't held accountable to this light, that has been in this movement from the very beginning. And to take this passage in early writings and make the application that they're making, okay, they can do that, but it's a denial of this entire message. And those people around the world that are thinking that they're in this movement and that these guys are the teachers that are clarifying this movement, they need to understand this is two different teachings across the board. So this is from Habakkuk's Tables. And whether you know it or not, Habakkuk's Tables was taken from old studies almost exclusively. There was a lot of new stuff in there too, but it was primarily just go into some old studies, cut and paste, and then go in and do worship the next morning over a period of time. And this is about overthrown. Who's overthrown? And you're going to see the quotes that are used have been used for many, many years in this movement. Go to page 11. I'll show you one. Just a one sentence from Testimonies, Volume 5, page 216. When the decree goes forth and the stamp is impressed, their character will remain pure and spotless for eternity. That's always been bedrock to this message. When the Sunday law arrives, your character is set for eternity one way or another. No, Brother Jeff, no, brother, we got great light now. When the Sunday law arrives, it's somewhere after there that your character gets set for eternity, because you can't get that seal until you're in the Sunday law crisis, because I've manipulated the writings of Ellen White to say so. And he wouldn't be giving me this great light if I wasn't right. This is scary stuff. Scary stuff that his disciples aren't even testing the applications that he's making on these passages. So let me go walk through here and finish. The notes are done. These are for you just to peruse, this study from Habakkuk's tables. We're having a shut door controversy here now, just like they had back here. And in our shut door controversy, without a doubt, they're distorting the spirit of prophecy, and they're putting a private interpretation into the spirit of prophecy. They're suggesting that when you get to midnight, that this has been typified by October 22nd, 1844, and on October 22nd, 1844, the Sabbath test arrived. But what they're not willing to acknowledge is this over here. They will acknowledge, they will quote often, that you can't have a third with what? Without a first and a second. Here's the first angel coming down on August 11th, 1840. We all know that. This is the second angel coming down on April 19th, 1844. If you got two angels coming down, what do you have to have? A third. The third comes down on October 22nd, 1844. These two histories here are telling histories of the judgment of the living. So if a triple application of prophecy demands that if this is telling the judgment of the living, the Protestants were being judged, the Millerites were being judged, the Protestants were alive, the Millerites were being alive. If this first angel and this second angel is illustrating the judgment of the living, that when that third angel comes down, it has to be illustrating the judgment of the living.
Amen.
That's why when Sister White is speaking about this history, she says, now the Sabbath test has arrived and the sealing has arrived. And it's the judgment of the living, the sealing message of the judgment of the living. And in this history, you have a visual here. The 1843 chart for the Protestants. You have the living testimony at the Exeter camp meeting for the Millerites. And here you have the marriage of James and Ellen White. Her name's changed. She's rebaptized. And they begin to keep Sabbath. All symbols of covenant. Okay? They're entering into covenant here, right in the center of this history. It's visual. Here, it ends when a door closes. The door on the Protestants closed on April 19th, 1844. Here is the door closing on October 22nd, 1844. And here in 1850, the number 50, you have the two charts in place. The two charts have been typified by the two Pentecostal loaves that were to be lifted up as an offering. These two charts back here have been typified by the Ten Commandments, but they're the Pentecostal wave offering, which typify the ensign being lifted up at the Sunday law. Number 50 marking the Sunday law. This history here, and they misuse this history in their applications, has to be applied in connection with this history and this history. And it's showing the judgment of the living. Just like this is showing the judgment of the living. Just like this is showing the judgment of the living. And here it begins when the third angel came down. When's the third angel come down in our history?
9/11.
At 9/11. The sealing begins. And it goes to here in 1850 when the door closes, which is midnight. Okay. So when they're saying that you get to midnight here and there's where the Sabbath test begins, because that's how it happened over here, they're taking snippets of her writings and doing just what Curtis and these other two people did in this history. They're resting her words to uphold a private interpretation. And there's two classes that get swept away right here. Because there's going to be two classes that get swept away on all these histories. One class is those people in Adventism that didn't pay any attention whatsoever to the light of 9/11. Then there's another class that profess to have accepted 9/11, profess to have received the Holy Spirit, that ultimately reject that message, come up with a new organization and a new message, and label the original organization as a delusion, or tag it as the Omega apostasy. That's happening right now as we speak. Heavenly Father, this teaching that is out there took some time to come to the surface about what the direction that it was heading, but now that it's there, it's quite scary. It was frustrating at first because it was propped up with some just blatant dishonesty. But now it's at the point to where it can clearly be seen, and it has turned from frustration to sadness, because it's amazing that some of the disciples of this movement used to be persons that would investigate passages more closely rather than just drink it in without testing to see if the application fits. We pray for these brethren because we know there's a promise that some of them have left the platform, would return and get back on. It's time that they start using the same kind of discernment that they're supposedly using against this message upon the leading voice of their movement, and see that he's now taking pieces of inspiration to uphold these false premises. What a warning flag. Give them discernment to act upon that and start testing these things, we pray. We pray blessing upon the rest of this Sabbath day for the conversation that we're going to have when we eat the physical food, and then the holy ceremony that we're going to have following that. We pray blessing upon this church family and this part of the Lord's vineyard, that you would make it a bright and shining light. And we'd ask that you continue to pour your latter rain out upon all of us here, that we might be fully prepared to stand during the coming crisis, as we can tell that what we've been understanding about the first 39 verses of Daniel 11 is becoming a present reality with the tensions that are escalating between Russia and the United States, in agreement with verse 10 of Daniel 11, the fact that we did not recognize that you held your hand over the understanding that Russia still had prophetic activities to perform here at the end of time. Give us the discernment to recognize these things and bring our lives into agreement, and continue to use this church family in a mighty way, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.